Okay, let us start our session. It's very good that one thing I want to apologize. I'm using Zoom again because I have tried all the other things. Either there is a lag, there is no quality or something or the other. This session I wanted to make it interactive. So on YouTube or an academy, it's not possible for me to have an interaction. So that if I, at least this session, I wanted to use Zoom. Okay, and I've told this session is based on the previous two sessions. Because you are all physiotherapists, I want you to understand how radiology can be used as an aid for radiotherapy. So first, before I go to today's session or discuss our sessions, I want to have a brief review. Okay, this thing is very important. So this video, as I've shown in the last time, this video is how the basic lumbar disc prolapse occurs and what are the symptoms at each stage of lumbar disc prolapse. So as I've told you in the last time, I will discuss once again. So this is the nucleus, this is the annulus. So what happens in a slip disc? In the stage one, first stage of the slip disc, there is a whole tear in the annulus. This is called annular tear. Can anyone from the BPT come on the voice? Can he unmute himself and start speaking?
They can raise their hand so that they will be unmuted. Anyone wants to go? You can raise your hand.
Initial first for 10-15 minutes will have some difficulty, but later on we'll get used to it. Anyone wants to answer?
Sir, repeat the question once so that they will be.
Yeah, this is the basic pathology of a lumbar disc prolapse. At every stage of the prolapse, you will have some specific symptoms which you need to know. Last time I've told you, and again I will help you. But one of you take a lead and try to answer. No one ready to answer? Dr. Apurva, all the people who have raised their hands previously?
Yeah, you can.
Don't hesitate, because this is all for bachelors of physiotherapy only. I know that you are doing your first year, second year and third year. So try to answer. Unless you answer, you will not be able to understand everything.
Krishna sir wants to go. Ashwini Jula has been raised.
Yeah, let her come on.
Yeah, Ashwini, you can go ahead. Yeah, Ashwini, you can speak now.
Yes, sir. Sir, the pain will be more on sitting.
Yeah.
And on bending activities.
Yeah. So, what is this stage called? Stage of? This is the stage of annular fissure.
Okay.
Right? So can you see this one? There's a tear in the annulus and nucleus pulposus is trying to go back. Now Ashwini, can you tell why is the pain more in flexion or extension?
More in flexion, sir.
Yeah. Is the pain more in sitting position or standing position?
Sitting.
Can you explain why is the pain more in flexion and not more in extension?
Because when a person is doing a flexion, the annulus fibrosis or the nucleus pulposus try to move backward. As the pressure is from anterior side, so the nucleus tend to move backward.
Yeah, but probably this is your explanation. But that is right. That is how we tell the layman people. But the scientific explanation is the intradiscal pressure is maximum in flexion and in sitting position.
Okay.
So because intradiscal pressure increases, the nucleus pulposus tries to come out.
Hmm.
Okay. So the first stage is actually stage of degeneration. Second stage is stage of annular fissure. Third stage will be
annular tear.
Second stage is annular tear. Annular tear and fissure are same.
Okay.
So next stage, the annular tear opens up. and the nucleus prolapse. And the expand. So next stage will be the stage of nuclear prolapse.
Prolapse.
But yet it has not touched the nerve root.
Nerve root.
So what will be the symptoms now? Dr. Ashwini?
Sir.
Yeah, what will be symptoms now? Will he have low back ache?
Yes, sir. He'll have low back pain. Long hour sitting increases the pain. Forward flexion increases the pain. But there will not be a radiating pain nor the neurological symptoms like tingling or numbness.
Yeah, but one thing is important. Compared to stage 2, the pain, low back ache in stage 3 will be more or less?
More, sir.
No, less. Because yes. In stage 2, there was not a complete tear. So, okay. Nucleus pulp was trying to come out. So, the intradiscal pressure was maximum.
Okay.
So, whenever a tear converts into complete prolapse, at this point, there will be temporarily relieving pain. The pain which was very severe, low back pain, which patient are not able to tolerate, now we'll be able to tolerate.
Okay.
So, a sudden decrease in pain is not always good.
Okay, sir.
So, what will be next stage?
Prolapse will concuss the nerve root.
Yeah. When it starts compressing nerve root, what will happen to nerve root?
Hypertrophy, neural hypertrophy.
Not hypertrophy, inflammation.
Inflammation, okay.
Okay. So, any structure which is inflamed in the body causes pain. So, what will be the symptoms of the patient now?
Tingling sensation, radiating pain.
Yeah. If you neglect more, what will happen?
They develop into numbness, sir.
Numbness, followed by? Weakness.
Weakness.
And in final stage, bowel and bladder retention.
Disturbances, okay.
Bowel and bladder disturbances, good. Is this way of interaction good for everyone?
Yes, sir.
Fine, okay. So, the entire symptoms and radiology is very important. But for lumbar disc, what I want to highlight is this pain is maximum in sitting position and this pain increases in flexion. And what is your basis of physiotherapy? You will discourage those movements which cause repetitive pain because repetitive pain means it's causing more damage to nerve, more damage to the annulus, more damage to the disc. So, as a physiotherapist, your aim is to decrease this repetitive movements which cause pain. So, unless you know the pain of a lumbar disc increases in flexion, you will not be able to decide what kind of treatment you need to give. So, from this picture, one thing for today's session which is very important is pain because of a lumbar disc increases in flexion. Fine. So, we'll go to the next one. This is the basic radiology which I have told last time. Can anyone try to answer again? Apart from Dr. Ashwini, is anyone ready to answer BPT? Kindly raise your hand. And very good, Ashwini. You have really done well. Dr. Srinivas, is anyone ready? Has anyone raised their hand?
No, sir. We are looking for that. You can just go to more option and there you can raise your hand. Yeah, Ashwini, again, she has raised. Any other person other than Ashwini?
Unless you people try to interact, you will not understand. This is radiology. This is a practical aspect. If I keep on speaking, it will like you have understood everything. But when it comes to when you come into your clinic, you will not be able to understand. And for MPT people, it's a cakewalk. Whatever I'm telling today, it's very basic for them. So if I ask them to answer, they'll be able to answer like anything. And again, you people will not be able to understand. If I ask Dr. Srinivas or Dr. Krishna to answer, they will answer at a stretch, which will be beyond your things.
Yeah, Sabha, you can go ahead.
This is a spine, anterior view of a spine vertebra, intervertebra. And...
Okay, Dr. Sabha. Yeah. Are you able to see my cursor?
Yes, sir.
So, what is this?
It is a body of the vertebra, intervertebral body.
Yeah, this cut which you are seeing is an axial cut or a sagittal cut?
Axial cut.
Okay, so this is all the bone. So yes, what is this bone called?
The transverse process.
No.
Spinous process.
Yeah, spinous this is spinous process. Our idea as a radiologist, as a physiotherapist is to identify the neural structures. As last time told, can you identify the head?
Yes, sir. Head and the hands.
Yeah, the hands are made. Cord. Yeah, what are the hands?
It transverse roots.
Roots, fine. They are the exiting nerve roots. Fine. Yes. So what is my head?
This is the spinal cord.
With the overlying dura mater and the CSF. So what is all this blue structure?
Spinal cord.
CSF.
CSF.
Within the CSF, you have either the nerve roots below the L1 or the cauda equina above the L1. Fine?
Yes, sir.
We'll be dealing with T2 weighted images. In T2 weighted images, what will be the color of CSF?
White.
White. So now, Sabha, be online. We will go to a real picture. Yeah. So, Dr. Sabha, what is this?
The intervertebral body.
Yeah. Are the disc? It depends on the level you have taken. If I take an axial cut at this level, this will be intervertebral body. If I take an axial cut through the disc, this will be a disc. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So, can you annotate the CSF?
1 second. Little bit side.
Yeah, everything which is white in color is the CSF.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell what I have pointed out? This one.
The trans spinal root, sir.
Exiting nerve root.
Yes.
Okay. This is also the exiting nerve root. This one which I'm marking now, is it right or left? Where my cursor is there. I'm drawing a circle here. So this is right nerve root or the left nerve root?
Left, sir.
Is everyone sure? The what use an MRI is opposite of your body. So this is the left one. Right. Now, in the small dots you are seeing, what are they?
No idea.
They are the nerve roots.
Okay.
These are all the traversing nerve roots which are present within the thecal sac. They have not yet come out of the spinal cord. Okay. So if I am able to see so many nerve roots, is this cut above L1 or below L1?
Above L1.
No, if it's above L1, I'll be seeing a solid spinal cord, the pons medullaris.
Okay.
This is cauda equina made up of so many individual nerve roots. So this cut is below L1. Okay?
Okay.
And one more structure. This is the posterior part of the disc. Is it concave or convex? So the posterior aspect of the disc is concave or convex?
Concave, sir.
Yeah.
Concave.
Is yes, everyone on the same word? Is it concave or convex? Answer on the chat. Concave. So the normal is concavity. If the concavity is lost, what does it mean? Disc has prolapsed. Am I clear?
Okay.
One more structure which you have to recognize is, can you see the black structure over here?
Yes, sir.
This black structure is known as a ligamentum flavum.
Okay.
Fine. Dr. Sabha, try to draw the ligamentum flavum once again. Each one of you try to identify the ligamentum flavum on your screen. Do not annotate, but you try to identify on your screen. No, no, no. Everyone is drawing. let Dr. Sabha draw it. Other people just mark it on your screen. Dr. Sabha, are you drawing?
Right? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Fine. So this is fine. Too many people are working on it. Fine. So this is ligamentum flavum. Fine. I will go to next screen. I think sagittal cat everyone will be able to easily identify. Should I revise that or not required?
One time you can tell, sir.
Okay. Yeah, actually now what you are seeing is if I give you both the cuts A and B, which one cut will be more useful for you? Fine, someone has answered B is T1, A is T2 because CSF is white in color. So that is what is my interest. I will be always looking for T2 cuts. Fine. Do not annotate until I ask, because once we annotate, the screen doesn't move until I clear it. In this picture, I want to show you, because Dr. Sabha has a doubt. So above L1, this is the spinal cord. This is called conus medullaris. Below L1, these are the spinal roots. This is the cauda equina. So if my axial cut is taken above L1, I'll be able to see this conus medullaris. And if I take it below L1, I will be able to see this one. So above L1, this spinal cord, and below L1, it's a conus. So can Dr. Sabha, can you tell me what is this which I'm showing? Dr. Sabha, is she there? Dr. Apurva will try. Dr. Srinivas, can you annotate Apurva? Unmute.
Sir, this is Krishna Chandran is ready, sir.
Yeah, conus medullaris.
Yeah, fine. This is conus medullaris. So this cut is above L1 or below L1?
Below L1, sir.
No, below L1, you have the spinal roots.
Yes, sorry, sir. Above L1.
Is there any confusion?
No, sir. It's okay. I understand, sir. Yeah.
Here, in this cut?
This is the Norwood, sir. Like Kodakuna.
Yeah, fine. Now, this is about the level of disc. So can you draw, annotate and show me the nucleus pulposus and the annulus?
Me, sir?
Yeah, you only.
Okay.
Everyone, do not annotate, but you can annotate, but other people just mark it on your screen. Mark it with a handle.
Sir, this was the nucleus pulposus.
Yeah.
And black one is annulus fibrosis.
Yeah, fine. So this is very clear. This is very important because you are dealing with a disc pathology. You will have to identify. We will have to identify the annular tear. You will have to identify the annular disc. So unless you know what is an annulus, what is a nucleus pulposus, you will not be able to tell. Okay. So let me draw once. So this one is the nucleus pulposus. Is the nucleus pulposus healthy or unhealthy in this case? What will happen to the color of nucleus pulposus when it becomes unhealthy?
White, sir.
What is the normal color, white or black?
White, sir.
Why is it white?
Because due to the more power of water in that nucleus pulposus, 70% of water.
Normal disc is hydrated. Water appears white on T2 weighted images. That is why even CSF appears white. So healthy nucleus pulposus is white in color. So when the disc starts degenerating, the water content decreases, so it becomes black. Second one is, what is the posterior surface of the disc, is it concave or convex?
Convex, sir.
Convex or concave in this case?
Concave.
So, normal is concave or convex?
Normally concave, sir.
Yeah. So, this is a normal disc. Disc is dehydrated. The posterior surface is concave. So, this disc appears to be normal.
Yeah.
Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then I will go to next slide. Yeah, and this one also, Dr. Srinivas, can you explain this entire animation to all the colleagues?
Yes, sir. I'll try my best.
Yeah.
So this is the facet joint, what you can see, which is articulating between the superior articulating facet of the above vertebrae and the inferior articulating facet of the above vertebrae and superior articulating facet of the below vertebrae.
Can you play the video or should I play?
I cannot do that, sir.
Okay.
Playing, you have.
Yeah.
So you can see there is an repetitive movement causes stretch related changes in the facet joints, which are, you can see the discoloration which is happening there between the intervertebral disc, that is increasing the intervertebral disc degeneration, along with that leads to the wear and tear near the facet joints. It's more or like osteoarthritic kind of thing, and you can see the bony spurs which are falling formation, and that leading to the pain and muscle spasm.
Yeah. Can any BPT try to answer a few questions on facet arthritis? Can anyone raise your hand? Someone wanted to answer previously. No one ready? Yeah, Dr. Fatima wants to answer, I think.
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. So facet arthritis, the pathology is, when I say a lumbar disc, Dr. Fatima, the pathology is in anterior part of spine or posterior part of the spine?
Sorry, can you repeat it, sir?
When I speak of lumbar, now we are comparing the symptoms of lumbar disc prolapse with the symptoms of facet arthritis.
Yes.
Because basically what I have seen is, see, when you get a patient from surgeons, you feel that every surgeon has done the same job. But there is some difference from a surgeon to surgeon.
Yes, so definitely.
From a patient to a physiotherapist, everyone has our own training, our own protocols, and everyone has your own experience with everything. One person may go to orthophysiotherapy, one person may go to neurophysiotherapy. So when I send a patient with lumbar disc and a patient with facet arthritis, what I see is majority of the cases, they are treated in the same way.
Yes.
How many of you do you actually treat the patient? Be frank enough, because this will allow in our discussion. How many of you know the difference in the treatment for lumbar disc and facet arthritis when the patient comes with a low back? Just say it in the chat. No? How many of you know? How many of you don't? Because if everyone knows, then there's no point in me spending a lot of time. So Dr. Payaz knows, Dr. ABC doesn't know, Dr. Krishna, Dr. Shraddha doesn't know, Dr. Krishna Pradhan. Yeah. What in my experience I've seen is, one thing is facet arthritis is underdiagnosed. Facet arthritis is a clinical diagnosis and less of a MRI diagnosis. And even neurosurgeons, neurophysicians don't give much importance to facet arthritis. So when we refer it to you, we refer it to you without mentioning that this patient requires treatment for facet arthritis. So by the end of this discussion with Fatima, we'll come to know why it's very important to differentiate facet arthritis from lumbar disc. So Fatima.
Yes, sir.
So the disc pathology in lumbar disc, is it anteriorly situated or posterior?
Posterior.
Lumbar disc. Anterior to the spinal cord or posterior to spinal cord?
Anterior to the spinal cord.
Yeah. In facet arthritis, it is?
Posterior to the spinal cord.
Okay. In facet arthritis, the structure which is involved are the facet joints.
Facet joints, yes.
The structure which is involved in lumbar disc prolapse is the intervertebral disc.
Intervertebral disc, yes.
Fine. The intervertebral disc pressure is maximum in flexion or extension?
Flexion.
The intra-facet joint pressure is maximum in flexion or extension?
Extension.
This is a basic difference. So the basic theory, what guiding principle in physiotherapy is, avoid those things which cause repeated to pain or damage. So in a lumbar disc prolapse, what is the movement which you are trying to avoid?
Flexion.
Flexion. In facet arthritis, what is the movement which you are trying to avoid?
Extension.
In lumbar disc prolapse, is a clinical diagnosis or a radiological diagnosis?
Radiological diagnosis.
No, both. Without clinical diagnosis, there is no radiological diagnosis.
Yes, but also radiological is involved, yeah, no sir? Fine.
It's clinical with radiological.
Yes, yes.
And practically, when a patient comes to you from a neurosurgeon or a neurophysician, he will be written, you will have a paper from them saying that he has a disc prolapse and so this level. Facet arthritis is a clinical diagnosis or a radiological diagnosis?
Clinical diagnosis.
Yeah, again, both. It's more of a clinical diagnosis, less of a radiological
Yes.
Okay. And when there is a, in second stage, when there is an annular tear in lumbar disc prolapse, what are the symptoms?
Annular tear, diffuse back pain.
Yeah. So, can you, as a physiotherapist, can you elaborate the clinical findings when a patient comes with an annular tear?
Okay. They mostly complain on pain and forward flexion, and diffuse back pain is there. At this point, tenderness might not be appreciated.
Yeah. I will ask you a few questions. If I ask the patient to use a finger and point me the point of pain, will he be able to do it?
In annular disc bulge, sir?
Yeah. In lumbar disc pathology?
No.
No.
Not in this second stage. Not in the second stage.
In third and fourth stages?
Not very appreciative, but yes, possible.
No. If it's a lumbar disc pathology, if you ask him to pinpoint with a finger, he will never be able to do it.
Okay. Yes.
Because the pain is a referred pain from the annulus.
Yes.
You can never palpate the annulus. You can never touch the nerve root.
Yes.
I will give an example. If I take a balloon, I start filling the balloon with air and air and air. Can you tell me where will the balloon rupture?
No.
No. Pressure is uniformly distributed.
Yes.
But if I take a pin and injure the balloon, can you tell where will it rupture?
Yes, it is.
Exactly the side where I puncture it.
Yes.
So, I have told you, the disc is situated more deeper from your back or more superficial from the back?
Deeper.
The facet joints are more superficial or deep?
Superficial.
Can I palpate a disc?
No.
Can I palpate a facet joint?
Yes.
So when I palpate a facet joint, can I elicit tenderness?
Yes.
So how many of you people you have seen that they use a thumb and point it on the lumbosacral dimple and say, this is my point of pain?
Yes, many. It's appreciable, sir.
So, if you are classically, if you are saying that unilaterally I have a pain at this joint, this is only pain, so that patient is suffering from?
Facet joint arthritis.
And when you examine, when you start pressing from the skin to the, you go to the bone and you have an impulse that you have touched the bone. You can easily make it up when you are touching the bone. So, at the same point where you touch the bone, the patient will wince with pain. So, this is the diagnosis of?
Sorry?
When you palpate, when you examine the patient mm-hmm. will say, I have pain over here, and you also point out. And when you palpate, at the moment your finger touches the bone, at the same point, the patient will have pain.
Yes, sir.
Are you clear how to examine for facet arthritis?
Yes, sir.
You can, from the midline, about a half an inch, you start pressing the patient. You start trying to elicit the tenderness. Whenever you touch the bone, whenever you feel the bone paraspinally at half inch to 1 inch, the patient will have pain. This pain is coming from the facet joints. This patient has facet arthritis.
Yes. Yes. Yes, sir.
Coming to this picture, see this. When the patient has facet arthritis, is the lumbar disc normal?
No.
No. Usually, this is a combined process. Patient will have lumbar disc degeneration along with facet arthritis. But thing is, one patient, even the both are degenerated. I will give an example.
Yes.
If I see patients at the age of 80, 75, 80 years, how many of them will have osteoarthritis? If I take an X-ray, how many percentage will have osteoarthritis?
Most of them will have it, sir.
But how many
80,
of them
80
will
to
have
90.
Pain? Yeah, 80 to 90% will have osteoarthritis. But yes. how many percent will have pain?
Around 40 to 50% will have pain.
Yeah. How many of them will just require physiotherapy? And how many of them will go for replacement? Approximately.
No, I am not able to.
Yeah, out of 40%, I can say 35% you will be able to manage with physiotherapy. Only 5% will go for knee replacement. Otherwise, it's like every elderly patient will have to replace the knee. That doesn't happen.
Yes.
Similarly, if you take an MRI at 80 to 90 years of age, everyone will have degenerative changes. Everyone will have facet arthritis. Everyone will have disc degeneration. But some people will have pain, some people will not have pain. So in every case, we'll have to assess whether the pain is coming from the lumbar disc or from the facet joints. So even though radiologically patient may have degeneration of lumbar disc and the facet arthritis, some people will have pain because of facet arthritis, some people will have pain because of degenerated disc, and some people may have both the components.
Both, yes.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
So you will have to, from your examination, which you are very good at, aided by radiology, you will have to decide which is the cause of pain.
Yes.
In 90% of the cases, where the affection is single level, you will be able to make out with your clinical judgment and radiological. The problem comes only when there's a multiple level and you want to decide which level to treat. Suppose your treatment is not affected by the number of levels involved, then it doesn't make much of a difference. So from this one, I wanted to highlight. So if I'm dealing with a lumbar disc pathology, what is the movement which I'm trying to avoid? Flexion or extension?
Extension.
Lumbar disc.
Lumbar disc flexion.
If I'm dealing with a facet arthritis, what are the things which I'm trying to avoid?
Extension.
Right. Is this basic difference clear to everyone? I want an answer in the chat. Yes, yes. This is a basic thing which you neurosurgeons follow. Do you want to continue or does anyone want to try the next one?
Sir, there are some doubts by Dr. Fayaz and Dr. Other person. So
yeah,
shall
you
we
ask them,
give
that?
Them? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Either they can ask or you can ask, Dr. Srinivas. I think Dr. Srinivas, you can answer on that. You can ask on that behalf.
Yeah, Ankit, you can. He's telling that how the flexion is going to cause injury.
Yeah, I have told you the intradiscal pressure is maximum in flexion. The intradiscal pressure is maximum in flexion. So any movement which causes repetitive flexion movements causes repetitive increase in the intradiscal pressure. This repetitive intradiscal increase in intradiscal pressure will cause dehydration and later damage to the lumbar disc.
Okay, sir, that is one of the philosophies, sir, which is written in books. But, sir, where I am practicing, I am seeing like 80 to 90% people are there used to do the work in flexion also, like they are from the village side. Okay, so my question is that, is it a valid reason that flexion lead to injury? If yes, can you justify the statement?
No, this is a basic thing. There's no justification required. There is no controversy also in this one.
Okay. Yeah.
This is a basic pathology. Basic pathology is that whenever you bend, whenever you flex, the pressure, all the joints in the anterior aspect of the spine will be taking the load. Is it clear? Is it clear, Dr. Srinivas? Actually, to whom was I speaking?
Dr. Ankit. Yeah, Ankit. Is it clear?
Ankit.
You can speak, Ankit.
Yeah.
So, okay. All the flexion movements will increase the pressure in the joints which are present. Are you able to see this picture?
Yeah.
I will just clear the annotation. All of you are doctors here. Don't annotate unnecessarily. Okay. So, what I am drawing now is the spinal cord. Okay. Ankit.
Yeah.
So all the structures which are present anterior, I'm writing as A. All the joints which are present posterior, I'm writing as P. Okay. So it's natural. You don't even require studies. Whenever the patient is bending down anteriorly, the pressure in the anterior joints will increase.
Yeah.
Am I clear, Ankit?
Yeah. Sir, but you are clear, sir, like it's so.
Whenever the patient bends posterior.
Sir, I have one question. One question is there. Sorry to interrupt again and again.
Yeah.
Like we have some six movement of vertebra also, like movement of the, like biomechanics of the vertebra.
Yeah.
So what if we said can lead to the more injury, sir, or like flexion you are telling, but how flexion is leading to the injury, it's a myth for me.
No, you'll have to read it. And there is nothing very complicated rocket science in it. Whenever the patient bends forward, there'll be, these two vertebrae will come nearby. That is a natural biomechanics. So this increases the pressure within the disc. Yeah. Whenever the patient bends backward, the similar pressure will be increasing in the similar, the posterior joints. The facet joints will take the pressure. So repetitive to flexion movements will injure the lumbar disc, and repetitive to extension movements will injure the facet joints.
Okay. Sir, can I join you?
Yeah. And Dr. Krishna, can you let him speak? Dr. Srinivas.
Yeah, sir. Both of them are unmuted. They can speak, Ankit and Dr. Krishna.
Yeah, Dr. Krishna, Dr. Ankit, you can continue.
Yeah, Ankit, I just want to add a point and answer your question here.
Yeah, let me introduce Dr. Krishna. Dr. Krishna is Master in Physiotherapy. He is actually my parallel, and we have done it at the same time. So, from the physiotherapy side, he will be speaking from the physiotherapy point of view. Yeah, Dr. Krishna, you can continue.
Thank you. Ankit, I want to answer your question actually.
Okay, sir.
Hello, I'm not able to hear you, Ankit.
Yes, sir.
See, what your I actually understood your question. The question is, how can a flexion cause injury? Sir, doesn't mean that it is an injury. The word injury has a broad sense. Even a long-standing degeneration is also called as injury scientifically. Okay, but the amount of injury, it is a micro injury. Okay. A long-standing degeneration is actually an accumulation of micro-injuries. So, all the small injuries in the annulus fibrosus will accumulate. They will accumulate over a long time, and they will lead to all the degenerative changes which are evident in the MRI. Okay. What sir meant by the word injury was, it was a micro-injury accumulating, integrating over a period of time, leading to degenerative changes. So flexion causing injury means, sir gave a statement that flexion will cause an injury. That means flexion over a period of time will cause degenerative changes in the posterior part of the disc. Okay, that is as simple as that. Okay, because obviously flexion will cause the posterior movement of the nucleus pulposus, and it causes a pressure on the annulus fibrosus, and it causes a tear over a period of time in the annulus fibrosus, and there is a protrusion. Is there anything else? Am I clear, Ankit?
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Dr. Krishna also tried to tell how to palpate the facet joint, because Dr. Harsh is repeatedly asking how to palpate the facet joint.
So apart from that, I'm interested to answer this. Actually, there are various methods of assessment. We follow some standard protocols in physiotherapy. More than palpation of facet joint, when it comes to the physiotherapy, more than in physical assessment, more than the palpation of the facet joints, some will be able to elicit the tenderness upon palpation, and some will not be able to, because palpation of the facet joints is actually trained in some vertebral mobilization classes. It is not trained for all physiotherapists.
Okay.
So majority of the physiotherapists, they have to depend on some physical tests. Yeah. So in a normal physiotherapy protocol, they we have like on first is the first comes history taking, then we'll go for on observation, on palpation, on examination. That is the routine physical assessment. So in that, when we go to on palpation, there are various methods. Like one writer says that it is at the one thumb lateral to the spinous process, and some authors say that it is half of the thumb. They give different kinds of measurements, but there is no consensus in that. When physiotherapists are not accurate in palpating the facet joints, they can go for clinical examination. In clinical examination, what they do is they'll ask, take a note of, even in the history taking, they take a note of all the positive postures and all the causative movements which are causing pain. So in the history, if we find that all the movements which mimic extension of the spine are causing pain, then we'll have to doubt the facet joint. That's the first thing. And in the history taking, if we listen to the patient saying that long-standing postures which are involving a relative extension, like a sitting on a chair with a poor back support, where the extensor muscles have to work for a long time, and there is a relative pressure on the facet joint. So these are meticulous understanding of the history, so which will make us proceed towards some specific clinical test. So once, I think I should be clear in this, okay? Once we suspect that there is a facet joint problem, we can confirm it through some physical test. The physical test simply involve the extension of the spine. That's it. So we can either ask the patient to stand erect and then slowly bend backwards, which can elicit pain. So bending backwards, if it elicits pain, it indicates there is a problem in the facet joint. Whether it's degeneration or something else will be sorted out later. But standing and bending backward slowly, if it elicits pain, and if the patient is able to point out then some specific points which are arbitrarily relating to the facet joints, then we can suspect facet joint better. Apart from that, if we want to further delineate, if we want to further concentrate on which facet joints are actually involved, we can ask the patient to bend back in standing. We can ask the patient to bend backward and turn to the same side. That will further cause compression of the facet joints.
Yeah.
So it can further elicit pain. And apart from that, in order to differentiate from the facet joint, degenerations on the other side, what we'll do is we'll make the patient stand, bend backwards, turn to the suspected side, and turn to the opposite side. So when the patient turns to the opposite side, there will be less pain. When we suspect on this side, then the patient bent backwards and turn to this side, the patient elicits more pain. So these are the practical physical assessments which are done based on the basic biomechanics of the spine, which are normally available in physical assessment books. And I may not be very clear in my language, but
You are good. I will tell from neuros how we examine. Can anyone take a lead? I will ask you a few questions how to elicit. Dr. Fayaz or anyone who has already answered, can they come online? One of you raise your hand, no? Dr. Harsh, will you be able to answer?
Sir, Dr. Fayaz is unmuted. He can answer.
Dr. Fayaz.
You can answer. Speak up. Hello?
Hello?
Fayaz. Because this one I want to take some time. Because when I'm saying that all my next principles are... Yeah, even Dr. Harsh can ask. Because it was... Dr. Harsh, are you? Can you speak? Dr. Harsh, okay, Dr. Fayaz. So unless you differentiate where the patient has faced it, Dr. Srinivas, can you unmute Dr. Harsh Nainwani?
Yes, sir, unmuted, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Harsh, this is very important. If you have any doubts, clear it right off here. Because yes, unless you know how to examine a facet arthritis, all my next webinar will be useless. Okay, yes, Dr. Harsh, this picture I'm seeing, suppose... this picture, I'm seeing the patient from back or side or front?
Back side.
From?
Back side.
No, this one. This picture.
Front, sir. Front.
No, this I'm seeing from the back. Okay?
Okay, sir.
This
okay.
Picture I'm seeing from the side. This picture I'm seeing from the front. So, this line which you have drawn is the midline.
Midline.
If I palpate there, the bony prominences which I see are what?
The transverse processes?
Spinous processes. Okay. Now, one finger breadth lateral to the midline. Okay, this is hardly one finger breadth. I palpate using my thumb. I press it with my thumb. So, what are these joints? Dr. Harsh, can you answer what are these joints?
Facet, sir.
Facet joints. So, when I press on the facet joints, you will be able to feel that now you have touched the bone.
Yes, sir.
When you touch the bone, at the same time, patient will have pain.
Okay.
So, when you are touching the facet joints, patient is having pain. So, what does it mean?
It is facet joint pain related to facet joint?
Yeah. Unless the facet joint is inflamed, that will not elicit pain.
Yes,
if I touch my normal knee joint, is it painful if I press my normal knee joint?
What? Not getting the word.
If you press your knee joint with your fingers, is it painful?
No, sir.
If someone is suffering from osteoarthritis, which is inflamed, palpate the knee joint, is painful?
Yes, sir.
So if you palpate the normal facet joints, is it painful?
No, sir.
If we palpate a joint which is inflamed, then it is?
Painful.
Usually the patient will be able to localize that my pain is coming from this point. If the pain is not severe enough, then you start from the lower down, you palpate the lowermost spinous process, you go one thumb breadth lateral to that one, and you start pressing, go gradually up, and you start pressing one after one. At one of the point, patient will wince the pain. And you can correlate that when your finger is touching the facet joint, then the patient is having pain. So that is nearly diagnostic of facet arthritis.
Okay, sir.
This patient, then you can correlate. When you ask a patient to extend, that pain will increase. And ask your patient to bend on the lateral flex on the same side, patient will increase. Pain will increase. If the flex is onto the opposite side, the pain will
decrease.
You bend down to the same side, pain will increase. You bend down to the opposite side, the pain will decrease.
But sir, I also one doubt is there.
Yeah.
The patient is bending to same side, and if pain is recurring, then it's only isolated to facet joint and or any other kind of pathology will be there, or only it will be related to facet joint only, not any kind of other pathology.
No, no. 90% is facet joint. Sometimes when your disc is eccentrically prolapsed, it is on the right side, even then the patient will have pain, but tenderness will not be there. You understood?
Okay, so my tenderness means when I will palpate, pain will not be there. My
will be
tenderness
there. Suppose the patient has a right foraminal disc prolapse.
Okay.
Then sir. When the patient bends on the right side, his radicular pain will increase, his low back pain will also increase, but you will not have a focal localized tenderness.
Okay, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
And I've told you, the pain because of annulus is never localized. The pain because of facet arthritis is majorly localized.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay?
Got it, sir. Yeah.
Okay. The next one will go. Next one which I wanted to tell you. Yeah. This patient, can anyone read the x-ray? Can anyone raise for, come forward?
You can raise your hands, who wants to go?
I hope this is not boring because I'm asking, waiting for people to ask. Yeah, Dr. Krishna wants to answer. Yeah, Dr. ABC probably is a junior. Dr. Krishna is a senior. He'll be able to answer everything. I will try to clear, but I'm not sure whether. Yeah. ABC.
Okay, sir. I'll let him answer and I'll wait for him. No problem. Yeah.
Hope, is it boring if I'm waiting for so much long time for people to take a lead? Or should I continue the same day?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. ABC, probably you won't hide your name, it's okay. Can you read the x-ray?
So I will try.
Yeah.
So this one, at the A x-ray is of the flexion and B is of the extension.
Fine.
Yeah, and we can see the vertebral bodies and the spinous process.
Yeah.
And the gap that is between the vertebral bodies, that is the intervertebral disc. We can also see the sacrum.
Yeah, fine. Can you draw the anterior vertebral line? Are you trying? Fine. Yeah. Now draw the posterior vertebral line. Yeah. You are on the same way, but I am clearing it once again. Clear all lines. So I am drawing. This is the posterior vertebral line. Okay. Are they all in a single line or not? Yes or no? Can you unmute Dr. ABC? Dr. Srinivas, can you unmute her? Is she unmuted?
Yes, sir.
When I'm drawing the posterior vertebral line, is the alignment maintained or not?
So it is slight of curve.
This curve is normal. This is normal lumbar lordosis.
Normal lumbar lordosis, yes.
Yeah, I'm drawing here. Okay. Can you see the gap here?
Yes, sir.
So what happened to the upper vertebra relative to the lower vertebra?
So upper vertebra flexion is more.
Is it moving anterior or posterior?
Yeah. Anterior.
So this patient has anterolisthesis or retrolisthesis?
Antero.
Antero. So what repetitive movement will be harmful to him? Flexion or extension?
flexion.
Yeah, this is the X-ray which I have taken in extension. This one, okay?
Yes, sir.
In extension, is the normal alignment maintained or not?
Sir, maintained, it is the lordosis curve.
Yeah, in flexion, are the just listhesis, is it more in flexion or extension?
Flexion.
Yeah, so which movement is causing listhesis?
Flexion.
So which movement is harmful to this patient?
Flexion.
So what exercises do you prescribe him? Flexion exercises or extension?
Extension exercises.
Fine. Doctor Das has said extension is harmful. Are you clear? Is what is harmful for him is extension or flexion? Here, what we neurosurgeons feel that for all the patients, physiotherapists will advise only flexion exercises. No. I will come for discussion later on, but are you at least able to clear this pathology is worsening in flexion? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We'll go to next one. Be online. If I have something. Okay. We'll come later on again. This is also flexion. No, I don't have that picture, so we'll come again. So basically, can you let Dr. ABC, can you tell, so what is the use of flexion extension images?
Yes, sir. Like we can find out what pathology is there.
Yeah, you can find out whether the pathology, particularly when there's a listhesis, you can tell whether listhesis is worsening in flexion or extension. So if the listhesis is worsening in flexion, you avoid hyperflexion. If the listhesis is worsening in extension, you will avoid extension.
Yes, okay? Sir.
Yeah, fine. Now, if these basic things, yeah, one thing which I wanted to ask, canal stenosis. What is canal stenosis?
I don't know.
Yeah, I will make. Were you there for the previous session?
No, sir.
Okay, we will try again, okay? Yeah. So, what is this? What is this white structure? This is, yeah, this is the canal. So, this entire white structure is known as the central canal. The contents of the central canal are the conus medullaris, cauda equina, the CSF and the thecal sac. This entire structure is called this one. What is labeled as SA? SA, lateral canal. So in canal stenosis, there is narrowing of the canal. Can you see? Here the central canal is narrowed. That is, the dimensions of my head will decrease. When the dimension, when the anteroposterior dimension of my head in the MRI is decreased, that is known as central canal stenosis. If there is decrease in contraction of my shoulder, then it is known as lateral canal stenosis. Am I clear? Yeah. This patient has central canal stenosis or lateral canal stenosis? Doctor, can you answer? At least in the chat, people answer no. This patient has central, this is a normal one. So this is entire white structure which you are seeing. So this in the white structure, in the center portion is lost. So this patient has central canal stenosis. Here, what happened to central one? This patient has both. He has a central canal stenosis and also a lateral canal stenosis on the right side. And also on the left side, but right side is more severe. See, this is the central canal. This is the right lateral canal. This is left lateral canal. Here the my head is also decreased in size. Even my shoulder is decreased in size. So this patient has a central canal stenosis and also a lateral canal stenosis. This patient?
Lateral.
Bilateral or unilateral?
More on one side and less, but both bilateral.
Which side is it more, right or left?
Sir, left.
Yeah, fine. Your right is left for the scan. So you will have to reverse it. So this patient has more on the left side.
Right.
So
right.
This patient has left canal stenosis. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then one more thing which I have to tell you, the dimensions of the lateral canal and the central canal decrease in extension and the dimensions increase in flexion. So the symptoms of canal stenosis are worse in flexion or extension.
So can you please pardon the question?
Yeah. Whenever we have the central canal, we have the lateral canal. So whenever the dimensions, when it narrows, patient will have more symptoms of canal stenosis.
Yes.
And the dimensions of the canal, when will the canal narrow, in flexion or extension?
Flexion.
No, in extension. Okay. So all the symptoms of canal stenosis worsen with flexion. Am I clear? Every one of you, there is no doubt. All the symptoms of canal stenosis worsen with extension. Patient will have relief with flexion. This is because the dimensions of the canal, they decrease in extension. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So let me summarize. The lumbar disc pathology, the intradiscal pressure increases in flexion or extension?
Flexion.
Yeah, facet arthritis, the intra-facet joint pressure increases in flexion or extension?
Extension.
Spondylolisthesis, the pain worsens in flexion or extension? Or variable?
Variable.
Variable. So that you will confirm with a flexion extension X-ray. Canal stenosis, the symptoms worsen in flexion or extension?
Extension.
Fine. This is the basic. This is what a neurosurgeon wants you people to know. Now we will go to the proper radiology and the case discussions. Okay?
So I have doubt.
Yeah.
So facet arthritis, it is like a tender point, like only particular facet joint is affected or all L1, L2, L3 like that?
It depends. If the patient is 70 years old, usually I'm from Hyderabad, you have a number of patients working the coal mines. So these people, they have all the smoke inhaling, which is not good for the health. It affects nearly all the joints, and even their work involves heavy weight lifting. So these people will come with all the joints involved. Suppose you see a patient at 23 years coming to your clinic saying that with one thumb he will say, this is my pain. So at this point he is having only one facet joint which is involved.
Okay.
If the patient has one facet joint involved, then we'll be able to treat the patient very well. But if has a diffuse pain, then the outcome is not very good.
Okay. Sir, it is like tender point if one facet joint is involved.
Yeah, tender point. And with experience, you'll be able to say that I've touched the joint and the patient is wincing at the same point. Then you don't require any other investigation. You know that is facet arthritis.
Okay.
But even if you diagnose facet arthritis, you require radiology because patient may have a coexisting disc bulge.
Yes.
Patient may have coexisting listhesis. Okay. So you need to know that patient has a disc bulge, patient has a facet arthritis also, but now patient has come with symptoms of facet arthritis. So I will have to treat the patient for facet arthritis now. Once the pain subsides, will your treatment modality remain same or not?
Not.
Why? This patient has lumbar disc prolapse also. So once the acute pain is relieved, the next successive treatment will focus at preventing the progress of degeneration, preventing the progress of facet arthritis also.
Yes, sir.
Am I clear? Otherwise, what happens is you cure the patient for facet arthritis now, but within 3-4 months, he will come back either with a recurrence of pain because of disc prolapse or recurrence of pain because of facet arthritis.
Yes, sir.
Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So now we will go into the proper one.
One question. Basically, nowadays, whenever a patient attends any neurological or neurosurgery or orthopedic OPD, the patient first they ask to go for an investigation is MRI. And whenever an MRI report is done, there are no dynamic views can be evaluated on an MRI. And there is an, we can appreciate there is an anterior listhesis. So how does the therapist can see, because general tendency as we are taught in our graduation days, like whenever there is an arthritis, it is an anterior shift of the vertebrae over the below vertebrae. And whenever you go for generally the low back exercises, we do extension. So again, we do this. So in this kind of scenario, what should be the physiotherapist? Again, we have to go for an X-ray, or whether we have to do, how should be?
Yeah, I have told you. Last time also I have told you. For me, at least for there is some difference of opinion even between neurophysicians and neurosurgeons. Fine. Neurophysicians, they diagnose and send it to you. Am I clear? Hello?
Yeah, sir.
Neurophysician, their approaches are different. They are more inclined towards medications. Neurosurgeons are more inclined towards physiotherapy and surgery also. I accept that. So when the patient comes to you from a neurosurgeon, every surgeon, for a surgeon, no investigation of lumbosacral spine is complete without an X-ray. But if the patient comes from to you from a neurophysician, neurophysicians have a tendency to get an MRI done. They don't depend much on an X-ray. So if the patient comes to you with only on MRI, do not hesitate to ask for a flexion extension views. Am I clear?
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
And flexion extension was 100-500 rupees here. What we are trained is, if you are asking for an investigation which is non-invasive, do not hesitate much because you're not harming the patient. But if you're asking for an investigation which is invasive, think 101 times. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Has anyone heard about a test called discography? Yes, sir.
I heard of it to measure the discal pressure.
No. When you do a clinical symptom elicitation, clinical examination, we have done an MRI, but even then I'm not able to make out whether that is the cause of pain or not. Then what I do is, I go into the disc, I put a needle into the disc, inject around 1 cc of saline. This is like increasing the intradiscal pressure. So if the patient has similar kind of pain, then that is the cause of pain. So this is an invasive method of diagnosing the cause of pain. And what we do is, once the patient gets pain, we inject 1 cc of Xylocan, which is local anesthetic. So all the pain which he had disappears, completely disappears. So now the cause of pain is coming from that particular disc or from that particular joint. So this is our final confirmation. But this is an invasive investigation. So we do only when I have a doubt regarding my diagnosis, or when I am contemplating surgery. Because when I'm contemplating surgery, I need to be 100% sure. Am I clear?
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
So if you, it's only an X-ray, you are not harming the patient in any way. You are not causing financial burden also. So when the patient comes to you, walks into your clinic only with an MRI lumbosacral spine, do not hesitate to ask for an X-ray lumbosacral spine flexion extension. The number of patients where X-ray lumbosacral spine was normal, MRI is normal, patient is being treated as non-specific back pain since years, and when you do a flexion extension, patient has a listhesis. Understood? Okay.
Sir, what does a time span actually to get a disc which has been anteriorly slipped? What does the time span, sir? It depends. Is there any literature saying that particular duration? Because some of the time he had a fracture due to a trauma or anything, but that would have been stabilized now. In the dynamic views, there is no much of in the flexion, it is the same, and it is the extension, it is the same. So it is stabilized there. So. Yeah. What to know, that what would be the time span?
No, for this takes long. You are asking me, if it's a fracture, it will heal in 3 months. But the spondylolisthesis which you see are usually degenerative. They are not because of fracture. So degenerative listhesis stabilizes. It does not heal. So it takes years to stabilize. So you will rarely see a patient in your practice where the mobility is there when he has presented. And when you keep treating the patient, the mobility will decrease. It will never happen. It will take years. You will have to have osteophytes which will unite the vertebra anteriorly, posteriorly. So this concept of number of times per spondylolisthesis is not there. Okay?
So,
yeah.
So if someone has a severe back pain and it is radiating to thigh, and but MRI is normal, then what can be the pathology?
We will discuss. I have a similar kind of case.
Okay.
Fine. Now can I start the case studies?
Yeah. Yeah, sir.
Yeah. Now identify 5 or 6, at least 7-8 people. Now we will actually interact. Now there is nothing from my side to teach. I have taught everything. Now you will have to decide. And Dr. Krishna and Dr. Srinivas, you moderate whether their approach is right or wrong. Okay. Now I have done my job. Now it's only you people which you have to decide. At least 7-8 people come forward and raise your hands. No. Who is going to take the first question? And before some physiotherapist, Dr. Srinivas. Srinivas.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Basically, when a neurosurgeon refers to you, we classically divide exercises which you are offering into 5 groups.
Okay.
One is the isometric exercises. Exercises involving movement from flexion to neutral, or neutral to mild flexion, hyperflexion exercises, hyperextension exercises, neutral to extension. Do you accept? Do you divide your exercises in a similar way?
Yeah, sir. Depending upon the presentation, we do flexion as well as extension also. Yeah, we do it, sir.
Yeah. Basically, I think you divide the exercises in isometric exercises and isotonic. Isotonic are where there are movements.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
In the movements, you divide into 2. Flexion exercises, extension. Right?
Exactly.
Yeah. In the flexion, we divide into 2 more. Those exercises which involve hyperflexion and those exercises which involve neutral to minimal flexion.
Yeah.
And even in extension, we have exercises which involve hyperextension and those which involve neutral to minimal extension. Am I right?
Yeah.
Who is going to take this this one? Any bachelor physiotherapist, BPT? This is very interesting. At least I feel these are very interesting for you to. You will identify yourself with your proper clinical cases. Dr. Fatima, do you want to try? I think Dr. Fatima will be able to try. Dr. Srinivas, can you unmute her?
Yes, sir. I'll do it.
Yes, sir.
Before I go, Mackenzie exercises are hyperextension exercises, hyperflexion?
Extension both exercises.
Extension and hyperextension.
Both, yeah. Mild as well as hyperextension.
Yeah. So I will not tell you what are hyperextensions. You are a better judge and you are trained better. And actually, I don't even know the name of those exercises. You can ask any neurophysician, any neurosurgeon, we don't know the names of these exercises. So we are practically lay people in that. I know only these 5 groups of exercises. So each session, you tell me what kind of exercises you are going to treat. What is your approach? So Fatima, and go with
yes,
the first
sir.
Exercise, no? First case. You first read the clinical symptoms and examination findings. Come to a valid diagnosis from the examination clinical symptoms. Then read the MRI. Correlate your diagnosis and then you will decide what treatment will do.
So you want me to read out the symptoms?
Yeah, read out.
Okay, 24 years male presented with low back pain since 4 to 5 months, complains of tingling and paresthesias in both lower limbs on walking, not exactly able to tell whether symptoms worsen with flexion or extension. With the examination, we are able to find out that there is a mild low back ache, no tender spots, no weakness or sensory loss.
Yeah. So clinically, what is he suffering from?
So diffuse disc bulge.
Okay, can be there.
Then because there is a little loss of convexity in this.
No. In the disc. Try to first come from the clinical symptoms.
Okay, so low back pain with tingling and paresthesias are suggestive of disc bulge.
Okay.
And
he may be having a disc bulge accepted. Is he having symptoms of facet arthritis?
No, because he is not able to tell whether there is a symptom change with flexion or extension.
And on examination, is he hinting regarding?
No, no tender spots or no facet joint arthritis ruled out.
Clinically, no facet arthritis. Facet arthritis is my clinical diagnosis. If the patient has facet arthritis and MRI, my clinical diagnosis takes it upper hand. Okay.
Yes.
So this patient has signs of, he has no symptoms of facet arthritis, he has symptoms of disc bulge. Does he have symptoms of canal stenosis?
Yes, canal stenosis.
Yeah, what are the symptoms of canal stenosis here?
Paresthesias,
right. Does he have symptoms of radicular pain?
Yes, tingling and paresthesias both.
No, radicular pain is more of pain. Patient will have a radiating pain. Superimposed on that, he will have tingling and paresthesia.
Okay, so first symptom should be noted as radicular pain. So we cannot consider tingling in that?
Yeah, no. If the patient has an acute disc, will have a radiating pain along with tingling and paresthesia.
Okay.
If the patient has canal stenosis or chronic disc bulge, he may have minimal radicular pain along with tingling and paresthesia. So, if the tingling and paresthesia are predominant, you will think in terms of canal stenosis, either central or lateral canal.
Yes. So, okay. This is a lateral canal stenosis?
Yeah. Now, read the MRI, no? We will go stepwise because I know you are a master of physiotherapy, so it's easy for you. But I feel that majority of the people in the audience are bachelors. So let them go step by step. By the time you come to fifth or sixth case, we'll be fast. Can you annotate? Can you show me the complete disc? Can you draw the complete disc in this
yes, device? Yes, sir.
Yeah, draw. No, absolutely wrong.
I'm sorry.
No. I mean to say,
no, I am not drawing that, sir.
We are all doctors here. Please let one draw. No? Srinivas, can you give the control of annotation to only one? Yeah.
I think that is, I don't know, sir, how to give this.
Yeah. I'm telling it once again. Only one of you draw me the outer border of the disc. Outer surface of the annulus.
So shall I proceed with the annulus?
Yeah, you proceed. You draw the outer border of the annulus.
I am indicating with the blue one, sir.
Okay, fine. Now show me the nucleus pulposus. Srinivas.
Sir, Dr. Srinivas. Yeah, sir.
Can you specifically give annotation power to only one person? Is it possible?
I am checking that actually.
Because if so many people are drawing,
I'll do that, sir. If I am, I'm trying that. Yeah. I'll see.
So probably everyone has drawn. So what is the color of nucleus pulposus now?
It's black, so degeneration.
Degenerate. So it's not a healthy disc.
Yes.
Second one. What is the surface? Shape of the posterior surface of the disc?
Normally should be concave, but here the concavity is a bit lost.
loss. It's more of flat. So even yes. annulus is bulging. Okay. Yes. Next one, what I want to draw is, draw me the ligamentum flavum. Many of you may not be able to identify ligamentum. That is why I'm specifically asking you to draw the ligamentum flavum. No. Everyone is wrong. Yeah. Someone is drawing with the red pen. Right. Now stop drawing, please. The one who has drawn with the red pen is the correct person. So this is the ligamentum flavum. Okay. There is an increase in thickness of the ligamentum flavum, which comes with your experience. Usual ligamentum flavum is very thin line. But here, there is an increase in thickness of the ligamentum flavum. Okay. Can now, there is canal stenosis. Is the canal stenosis more of central canal stenosis or lateral canal stenosis?
Lateral canal stenosis.
Yeah. Fatima, draw my head. Draw the central canal.
Yes, sir.
No, it's wrong. Draw again. Yeah. Probably red color is yours, Fatima.
No, sir. I didn't draw that.
Okay.
I was about to draw it.
Yeah, but where has drawn? That is the central canal. Fatima, now try to draw the lateral canal. Lateral canal is my shoulder.
This, sir?
Yeah. I will draw. Yeah. This region is the lateral canal, where you are not able to see the CSF. Right. So, there is bilateral lateral canal stenosis. So, this patient has a degenerated disc. This patient has canal stenosis, which is lateral canal. There is no facet arthritis. So, how do you treat the patient now? Atima.
Yes, sir. Tell me 1 minute.
So, will you advise this patient flexion-based exercises and extension-based exercises?
Flexion-based exercises, sir.
Think over. There are two pathologies here. Patient has a canal stenosis and also a disc bulge. For disc bulge, what exercises do you offer?
For disc bulge, extension exercises, sir.
Okay. For canal stenosis?
Flexion-based.
This patient has both or one?
Both.
But is clinically presenting to you with more of symptoms of disc bulge or canal stenosis?
Canal stenosis.
So, which exercises will you offer?
Flexion exercises.
In flexion, I said there are two exercises. One is minimal
hyperflexion. Yes, not hyperflexion, but minimal flexion exercises. Basically, sir, I'll just try to share you how do we basically treat if there is a such kind of presentation. Yeah. We say low-grade flexion exercises, and we also try to strengthen their core muscles, sir.
Yeah, right.
So this is the approach we basically use.
Yeah, basically for all these spine cases, you will have to strengthen the core. You'll have to strengthen the spine also. There is no controversy in this, but it depends on what kind of exercises, what amount of movements are you doing. As you have said, in this patient, I will strengthen the core muscles also, I will strengthen the extensors also. But I will not prescribe exercises which are hyperflexion.
Yes, sir.
Even though patient has a disc bulge, can I advise him hyperextension McKenzie exercises for him?
No.
No. At the same time, I can't even advise him hyperflexion.
Yes, sir.
But at presentation, I will concentrate on flexion exercises so that he'll be relieved of paresthesias. Once the paresthesias are relieved, then I will give equal importance to both flexion and extension exercises.
Yes, sir.
So, can you appreciate how radiology improves your approach?
Yes, sir, it is definitely, because till now specifically with my experience, I'm telling, we were not so precise in finding out the radiological findings. MRI, we just used to see the disc bulge basically. in the axial cut, but we couldn't appreciate the ligamentum flavum and everything because I just have to, it's just 1 year of experience for me now, sir.
Fine.
In practicing.
No, but you are actually very good in an approach. Dr. Krishna and Dr. Srinivas, do you agree with her approach or do you have a different approach?
She's excellent, sir. She's fine.
Anyone, does everyone agree with this approach or does anyone has a different opinion to share? See, this is what is my experience, this is what I feel the majority of neurosurgeons follow, but even with this, there is a lot of controversy in the kind of exercises you prescribe. Every institute has its own approach, its own protocol. But whatever we feel it's logical and whatever we feel that patient is improving, to be followed. Okay. So, is everyone agreeing with this approach of treatment for this patient? Yes or no? Or does anyone want to debate? Are all the participants there? Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir. We have 58 participants.
Yeah. Shall we go to the next case?
Sir, Krishna sir was wanted to tell something. He can go ahead.
Yeah, Dr. Krishna.
Yeah, actually, in approximately a decade before, there were like hard and fast rules like stenosis. These are the exercises that should be prescribed. But disc prolapse, these are the exercises. But now, there is more a combination and we keep grading the symptoms. We keep grading based on the symptoms, based on the signs, and we fluctuate from static to dynamic exercises and we have a fine balance. Flexion exercises are also employed and extension exercises are also employed with a fine balance between dynamic and static exercises. So that all is actually finer ramification found in physical assessments and treatments. That's only an add-on point which I wanted to tell to all the physiotherapists, to all the undergraduates.
Sir, I would like to ask one question at this point of time. Sir, whenever we think of administering the treatment protocol to the patients, we say that treat not the symptoms, treat the root cause. So here the root cause is the hypertrophy of the ligamentum flavum. So there are different causes for the hypertrophy of ligamentum flavum, not only the degeneration or disc bulge which is compressing. So what could be the reason for in this condition the causing the hypertrophy of ligamentum flavum?
Ligamentum flavum hypertrophy is 99% degenerative.
Sir,
either degenerative or because of fluorosis.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Any
inflammatory conditions?
No. Very rare you can say rheumatoid arthritis and all these things, but they're very, very rare. You can say that 99, if not 99, at least 95% of your practice will be degenerative.
Okay, sir.
And there is no treatment apart from surgery where you can decrease the bulk of the ligamentum flavum.
And so, one piece of advice to the junior physios, whenever you are documenting, whenever you are giving the William flexion exercises or McKenzie exercises, please do, as Fatima has rightly pointed out, grade 1, grade 2, and whenever you are going for those Superman exercises where you are contralateral limb raises, please do extend so that they will have a clear understanding whether what kind of exercises we are doing. That communication is very important. So if you could draw a stick diagram or any proper documentation, that would also give a good communication between the neurosurgeon as well as a physiotherapist.
And believe me, even if you go to a neurosurgeon, we don't have the concept of type of exercises. So you will have to educate your neurosurgeon, you will have to form a group with your neurosurgeon, neurophysician, and then slowly try to tell them that there are different kind of exercises. I think majority of people will refer it to you just for physiotherapy, am I right?
Yes, sir, yes.
Yeah.
So this is your region of expertise. You need to tell them, sir, I want this information, I'm treating the patient with this way, and slowly they will come to come into your way. Okay, so let's go for the next one. Who is going to try this? And Dr. Fatima, are you online?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yeah. One thing, so okay, I will call you once again. We'll go for the next case where it's more clear. Yeah, Dr. Fatima, it's the same case. Can you read this MRI?
Lesion is at the level of L3, L4, sir.
Where? Can you point it out? Where is the lesion?
This one, sir?
Yeah, that is... this is L4, L5, no. This is S1.
L4,
L5. Yeah, L4, L5. Now, you have pointed out with an arrow, blue arrow. Can you tell what is this?
Sorry?
You have pointed out with a blue arrow. What is that structure? Can you tell the structure where my arrow is there, where my cursor is there?
There is a lot of annotations, sir, actually. Yeah.
This one. Yes. My cursor will be unique.
Central canal, sir.
No. This black structure. It's there.
Ligamentum flavum.
Yeah. Can you appreciate the ligamentum flavum here compared to other places?
Yes, it's completely hypertrophied.
So, it's easier, if it's a central canal stenosis, it's easier to appreciate in the sagittal cutso.
Okay, yes.
So, this compression is coming from the posterior.
Yes.
So, it's very easy to identify. Okay. Now, case 2. Can anyone take up? Dr. Srinivas, can you identify someone who will be able to answer?
Yeah, Rucha, you can go ahead. Rucha.
Someone is asking me to clear the...
Rucha, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can try this. Rucha is a BPT student, sir, and she has accepted to answer. You can go ahead.
Yeah, Rucha, so read the clinical symptoms, history, complete diagnosis, then read the MRI, then try to work out the plan.
The patient is a 42 years male. Symptoms are low back pain since 4 to 5 months. Sudden onset severe pain which gradually decreased to mild to moderate pain now. Also complaints of tingling and paresthesias in both lower limbs on walking. Pain increasing on flexion. On examination, mild low back ache. No tender spots, no weakness or sensory loss.
Okay. So from clinical examination, do you want any other symptoms for me to tell? Or is this examination and history sufficient for you? If you want any other inputs to be given from my side, I will give it. Harry, this is okay. Can you try to come to a diagnosis?
Can you just give me a second?
Yeah, you take your time. There is no hurry. There are around 10 cases. You can complete with 2 or 3 cases this time. Can you can postpone to next session? It's okay.
So this is the case of.
Do not look at the radiology now. Just look at the symptoms.
Okay. So according to symptoms, there is a severe pain which gradually decreased to mild to moderate pain now. Yeah. So there might be the third stage, which is disc prolapse.
Okay.
In the, And there's also complaint of tingling and paresthesias in both the lower limbs on walking.
Yeah.
And pain is increasing on flexion.
Fine.
So, it gives an idea of disc bulge.
Yeah. If pain is increasing in flexion, it can be either a disc bulge or an anterolisthesis.
Anterolisthesis, sorry. Yeah.
So if he's specifically able to say pain is increasing flexion, yes. So you'll have to think of a discal. Are there anterolisthesis?
Yes, sir.
Second, are there any features from the history and examination to suggest there is a coexistent facet arthritis?
I cannot say that, sir, because there is nothing is mentioned as such that the pain can be pointed out.
No. After
there are no tender spots. No tender spots.
After examination, I can't say that there is no facet arthritis. I don't have the information. If I have completed my examination, I will have to say sure whether there is a coexistent facet arthritis or not. If there are no tender spots, there is no segment facet arthritis.
Okay.
This is a clinical diagnosis. MRI may show facet degeneration and many things, but now is not symptomatic for facet arthritis.
Okay.
Right. Is there nerve impingement or not?
So it might be there because there's a there's a complaint of tingling and paresthesias in both the lower limbs and the pain. The tingling sensation and paresthesia.
Okay. So this patient has symptoms of disc prolapse. He has no symptoms of facet arthritis. Does he have symptoms of canal stenosis?
So there's a pain increasing on flexion. So that might be suggestive of that, if I'm not wrong.
No. What are symptoms of canal stenosis?
Pain should increase in expansion.
No. Canal stenosis is more of paresthesias, less of pain.
Yeah. Yeah.
Canal stenosis is paresthesias will increase in extension and they are relieved in flexion.
Okay.
Am I clear? When the word pain comes, you don't think majority of canal stenosis. Whenever there is a pain, you think of either disc bulge or a nerve inflammation, that is radicular pain, or a listhesis, or an inflammation of facet. So whenever there is pain, there is either mobility or inflammation.
Okay.
So inflammation of disc is disc bulge. Inflammation of facet joint is facet arthritis.
Yes, sir.
In spondylolisthesis, it's mobility, movement of one vertebra over the other. Whereas in canal stenosis, is a decrease in volume, decrease in pressure because of compression. So whenever a patient thinks of paresthesias, you think of canal stenosis, either lateral canal stenosis or central canal stenosis. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So this patient also has symptoms of canal stenosis.
Yes, sir.
So now read the radiology.
I request all the participants not to write all those things, please.
Yeah.
So there's a herniation present at the level of L3, between L3 and L4. This herniation. And that's...
You are able to see my cursor?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is this disc normal? What is the color of the disc?
It's dark.
So is it degenerated?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is this disc normal?
No.
Is this L5-S1 normal?
So it shows the dark color of the disc.
So this patient has multiple disc prolapse, not a single one.
Yes, sir.
It's not a single one. And second one, what is this? In last session, I have told you.
Migrated, if I'm not wrong, migrated disc.
No. This is a white signal in the posterior part of the annulus. In this picture, in this disc, which is normal, this is the white structure is the nucleus pulposus. And this black structure is the annulus, outer line. Can you draw it? I will show you. I will draw myself. See, this one is the nucleus pulposus, this small one. See, This one is the nucleus pulposus. The one between these two circles is the annulus.
Annulus.
Okay. So, what happened to the annulus here? Can you see a white spot in it? Are you able to see a white spot in it?
Yes, sir.
That is known as hyperintense zone. That is the annular tear.
Yes, sir.
So, that was the cause of pain which he had 4 to 5 months back.
Okay.
And that annular tear heals in 3 weeks to 3 months. So as it starts healing, patient will have decrease in pain.
Okay.
And this MRI was taken that 4 to 6 months back. This is not a fresh MRI.
Yes, sir.
Okay, am I clear? Can you correlate the history with this MRI now?
Yes, sir.
So 4 to 5 months back, patient already had a multiple disc degeneration. So before 4 to 5 months also, if you ask him, he will say that I had mild low back ache, which was not significant. 4 to 5 months back, I had a sudden onset pain because that at that time I had an annular tear. After yes, having annular tear, I took some conservative treatment. This annular tear healed. So my low back ache has gradually decreased. Because of this disc bulge, there is some residual canal stenosis. So because of that canal stenosis, I have my paresthesias now.
Yes, sir.
Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what exercises do you advise for him? Flexion based or extension based?
Extension based, because the person extension based exercises.
Yeah. Now the patient has low back pain. Now entire pathology is not, is it because of ligamentum flavum or disc?
Disc mainly.
Yeah. Canal stenosis may be because of disc. It cannot be because of ligamentum flavum hypertrophy.
Ligamentum flavum.
Because of disc, you treat the disc. If the canal stenosis is because of ligamentum flavum, you treat the ligamentum flavum. So this patient is symptomatic because of the disc. So you give exercises which are based on extension. Can I allow hyperextension McKenzie exercises for him?
Sorry, sir. Can you please repeat
the question? Can I allow hyperextension McKenzie exercises for him?
Hyperextension, I guess, cannot be advised.
Why? There's nothing. You don't have symptoms of facet arthritis. There's no listhesis. There is no ligamentum flavum hypertrophy. So this patient has pure disc pathology. So this patient, we can allow hyperextension McKenzie exercise.
Okay.
You start with low grade and the patient is able to do it, then you can gradually extend hyperextension McKenzie also. Okay, am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Are you people getting bored? Should I continue with the cases or can I postpone the cases?
Sir, we'll do one more and we will.
Yeah. Last case, very simple one. Should I put it?
Proceed. Sir, before we proceed, I have one small doubt.
Yeah.
I think this is a mixed sagittal view of the spine, sir. Right?
In MRI. This is a neutral view.
Okay. I mean, can I call it mixed sagittal view?
I didn't get you. Can you ask again?
Can we call it mid sagittal view?
Yeah, this is a mid sagittal view. Right.
Okay. Can we, sir, I'm more worried about the first arrow. First arrow which is pointing out. What is actual pathology? Yeah.
Yeah.
What's the pathology, sir? It's pointing out.
No, there's nothing there. It's nothing there actually.
Okay.
They were showing that at the level of the vertebral body, nothing is there. At the level of the disc, there is compression.
Okay, that's the compression. Okay.
Yeah.
Can we call it
internet? So they wanted to tell that. That's all.
Okay. Can we? Okay.
last case, very simple one. Can anyone take it up? Yeah, very simple one.
Hello, Ayushi. Hello? Hello?
Yeah, now everyone is able to hear. Can everyone of you unmute? If everyone is having prayers, should I make any changes in the timing of this session? Is 7 to 8 okay? Yeah, first question, shall we stop or shall we continue? I think we'll stop because many people are having their prayers. No, many people are having their prayers. So it's not good that I continue. And is 7 to 8 session okay for you or should I change the timings?
So we can start at 6, sir. 6 o'clock?
Fine. It's okay. Next time we'll start at 6.
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
No issues.
Again, 6 will not be overlapping with the prayer, right? Anyone?
That I'm not sure. 6:40, they have to break our fast. So can you tell, is any time in the morning okay? Any time after 4 is okay for me. Can we take from 5 to 6:30, 1.5 hour?
Yeah, that would be good time, sir, because that will not hamper their fasting timings also. Yeah, 5 to 6:30. Yeah, sir.
Yeah, that will be okay because I have my work until 4. So 5 to 6:30 will be okay for me.
Yeah, sir. Everyone is asking when will be the next class.
Next session, next session is on basics of this one. Last time I was stopped with the functional session of the cerebral hemisphere. I'll continue with that one on Tuesday. And Friday, should I continue with the remaining cases or should I go to a second session? And any other session? Is this kind of discussion okay or is it boring? If you are okay with this discussion, I think I have more 8 to 9 cases. We can continue with the remaining cases.
We can continue with the remaining cases and then we can go with the neuroanatomy, sir.
Okay, fine. So everyone, Tuesday, you want me to present this, complete this?
Yeah, sir. A review of all and then for 10 minutes and then cases and then their experiences, what they would do. And next class, we will start the neuroanatomy.
Fine. So next, in this Tuesday from 5 to 6:30, we'll have this session. Fine.
The same ID or you will be posting in the group, sir? Everyone is asking.
No, Zoom ID always changes. So I will post it again.
Okay, sir. Okay. No, sir, you can use the same ID actually, because whenever you're using, there is an option to use the same ID actually.
Recurring ID, no? Okay.
Yeah, same ID, you can use it. But it's okay, sir. You can
post it. I will post
that,
in you, because one of my uncle is also using same ID and is very much senior to me. So I shouldn't clash with his sessions. So
okay,
I will post it again.
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for making this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for really, we would like to thank on behalf of all the participants. We had around 80 participants who have joined the session, and you being in spite of busy schedule, being a neurosurgeon, helping the physio community and teaching them the best clinical parts, we can see that our own physios are doing a radiology course for 25,000 and you giving it for free of knowledge. We are deeply indebted to you and we are really moved by the teaching what you are giving us. Really, we are happy, sir. Happy.
No, actually, it's my selfishness. Unless until post-operative physiotherapy is good, my patients will never be happy. And I understood that it's only because of miscommunication. Actually, not miscommunication, no communication. So yes, I thought that I will start. And physiotherapists at my institute are really good. They communicate really well. So I thought that this communication should be encouraged everywhere. So we'll stop from. Thank you, everyone. And even in the next session, I want the same. This session. Thank you, everyone.